الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد أما بعد. So in the previous video we talked about contingent beings and we said what is a contingent being? We said anything that changes, anything that doesn't have to be the way it is, anything that has a beginning to the existence but didn't have to exist, anything that has attributes but could be in another form, or limits but could be in another form, or could be arranged in another way. All of these things would make us validly ask the question, why is it that way as opposed to another way, i.e. what causes that thing? And we use this process, this question, when we come to the issue of science and we investigate the explanations behind things, or the mechanical explanations behind things, or when it comes to the questions, you know, the mundane matters, when we see things around us and there's change and we're asking what's caused that change. This is how we operate. This is how we understand and comprehend the universe around us, by this idea of contingency. And so in the previous video, what we said was that limited things are dependent upon other limited things, are dependent upon other limited in this chain of events. And this chain of events cannot regress back forever. It must have a beginning. That beginning must be an independent being. If it's dependent, then it's back in the chain. So it has to be independent. For it to be independent, it has to be something other than limited. Therefore, it has to be unlimited. It has to be something other than contingent. Therefore, it has to be a necessary being, not a possible being, but has to exist, and therefore eternal, etc. So we talked about this from this perspective. But we should also appreciate that we can prove the existence of the creator, this necessary being, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exists, even without necessarily going through this chain of events, you know, what we maybe term temporal causation. We can prove that the creator exists by asking the question, why does this particular object have these particular attributes? What is the explanation behind that? And the only possible way to explain it ultimately requires the existence of a necessary being. So let me try and elucidate and explain that further. When we look at, for example, water boiling, and we say, well, why does water flow? Why does it flow at room conditions? You know, normal condition, 20 degrees Celsius, in one atmosphere, it's a liquid. So why does it flow as a liquid? What we tend to do is we tend to say, okay, it's the reason behind it is because of what it's made up of. But what it's made up of is not actually the reason of why the water flows. The reason why water flows is something other than what it's made up of. And I'll explain what I mean by this. Water, let's say, as an example, the reason why it flows is because of the, you know, the hydrogen bonding. So you have water molecule, H2O, and you have between one molecule of water and another molecule of water is a hydrogen bonding. It's a weak bond. Yeah, it's like a weak magnetic bond. And therefore, it's not rigid like a solid, but rather it's able to flow and move over each other, hence a liquid. And it's not, you know, completely separate, either there's no bond, and so you just have free hydrogen H2O within the atmosphere, and therefore that would be a gas. So it's at that state where it's where you have this weak hydrogen bonding between two molecules. I know it's science. I know sometimes we don't like to go and talk about these things, but it's not really the science that I'm explaining. I'm using the science to explain the point that it doesn't actually provide us an explanation of why water flows. So let's go a bit further. Okay, why does the hydrogen bonding exist? Why is the hydrogen bonding? Well, they say that's because the proton inside the nucleus of the oxygen atom is positively charged. And because it's positively charged, it attracts, and there's lots of, I think there's about 8 protons or so, I think so. Maybe somebody in the comment section or whatever can correct me later. But there's a number of protons, they're positive, and they attract the electrons to it, because the electrons are negative, the protons are positive, so they're attracting it. And so if they're not only attracting their own electrons to the core, but also they're going to start attracting the electrons from the hydrogen, the single electron from the hydrogen. So as a result, the hydrogen becomes, that part of the molecule becomes more positive, and the oxygen becomes more negative. So it's like you're creating a magnet. You know, you've got a positive end and a negative end, two poles, and the positive will attract the negative, and the negative will attract the positive. So you're creating this, and that's what they call the hydrogen bonding. This is what they claim is the explanation behind why water flows. But actually, it's not really an explanation, because what we are simply doing is explaining the mechanics of it, the mechanistic explanation, if you want to say. But we're not really giving the explanation of agency, why it exists in the first place. Why is it that a proton is a positive charged particle? Why is an electron a negative charged particle? Now look, they might turn around and say, the reason why an electron is positive, is negative, is because of its rotation. If it rotates the other way, it's positive. If it rotates this way, it's negative. Most of the electrons rotate or spin. So if it spins this way, spins in a way which makes it negative. Okay, but why does the spinning cause something to be negative or positive, as an example? People might turn around and start saying, well, you have the Higgs boson field. The Higgs boson field provides matter with its properties and its mass and things like that. Yeah? But then you're still asking the question, why is the Higgs boson field, why does it have those attributes as opposed to other attributes, and why does it give those attributes to the electron, and so on and so forth? So every single explanation as to why water flows is not really providing a fundamental explanation. It's simply shifting the explanation to something else, which shifts it to something else. Now, there's two possibilities. In fact, some of you might think, well, it sounds like the chain of events, and it is like the chain of events, but that's temporal. That's going back in time. We're not going back in time. We're looking at water flowing right now and asking what is the reason for it. And we're shifting the explanation, keep shifting it back to the next thing, and to the next thing, and to the next thing. So can it go on forever? You can't have an infinite regress. And if you can't have an infinite regression, as we mentioned about the dominoes example, then you need to have something that is the explanation. Now, if it's the explanation, then it can't be something that's contingent, meaning that it has attributes, but it could be in another way. Or that it has a beginning to existence, or that it follows regulations and laws, but it could have followed different laws. Because this question then becomes, who determined it to be like that? And so the only explanation we have is that there must be a necessary being, not a contingent being. And that the necessary being imposed laws and attributes on the Higgs boson, on muons, on electrons, on protons, on neutrons, on hydrogen molecules, on hydrogen bonding, and upon the water flowing. That somebody's imposed this system upon it. Now somebody might say, well, how come, why are we saying that this is a sentient being, a being that chose, is willful? Why can't we just say some sort of, you know, really, really fundamental, simple particle out there that is necessary? Well, there's a number of explanations for that, but the primary explanation that I'm going to focus here is to say this, is that when you have a number of possible attributes, water doesn't have to flow. Electrons don't have to be negative. Protons don't have to be positive. The laws and the forces that exist within nature don't have to be the way they are. There's a number of possibilities. You've got a number of possibilities to choose from. If you choose this one, it's not something that is capable from something that has no ability to choose or has a will to decide. Therefore, because we have possible beings, you need a necessary being that chose what type of attribute that thing has. And this point about regards to the proof of the existence of the creator is not just about, you know, in the distant past. Yeah, before the Big Bang, there was a creator and started this initiation of creation, as we mentioned in the previous video. This explanation of the existence of the creator requires a creator to be active and constantly sustain the creation. So not just create and originate creation, but maintain and sustain the creation. And in the Quran, it mentions the very famous verse of Quran known as Ayatul Kursi, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, or the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran says, Allah, none has right to be worshipped but He, the ever living, the one who sustains and protects all that exists. Neither slumber nor sleep overtake Him, and to Him belongs whatever's in the heavens and whatever's on the earth. And who is he who can intercede with Him except with His permission? And the verse carries on. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning the point that He sustains the universe. He makes the water flow. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the explanation as to why water flows, why we have attributes, why the universe has attributes, why every single star and planet has attributes, every single atom and subatomic particle has attributes the way that they are, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is maintaining it. And when we really fathom that, and the verse says, neither slumber nor sleep, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is maintaining this entire universe, and it doesn't even tire this necessary independent being, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The only thing that we can say is, subhanAllah.